So my name is Vikram. I work for the Accountability Initiative, which is a policy organization looking at, we try to understand implementation structures at a very grassroots level in government. So at the policy and the armchair understanding of why things work and why things don't work is usually at a very high level. So we say things like, oh, the NRG is a good scheme, the NRG is a bad scheme, you know, we need to do this, the land bill is good, land is bad. But nevertheless, even the best design scheme and the best design program runs into lots of problems at a very grassroots level because of various issues. So we attempt to try and look at some of these problems at the grassroots level. And primarily our lens for the past few years has been education. So unfortunately though, given the galaxy of wonderful speakers we've had today, I find myself in the rather odd position that everything I want to say has already been said by everybody else. So therefore I request your patience, and all I can promise you is a slightly different lens at looking at something which have already been made. So perhaps a different perspective will give some value. Okay, so this is a basic outline of my talk. I'll just show you a brief look at the structure of the public education system, just to, I'll show you that next. I'll also run through a brief overview of the data collected and used in the system. Much of this stuff will be familiar to you, given that we've had speakers from DICE and NAS and Parthage as well who ran us through that already. So I'll be brief about this part. Then I'll talk about weaknesses in the data framework and some of AI's ideas on how we have and how data can be used to catalyze reform in the system. Okay, so this is a simplified look at the public education system structure in our country. I just simplified, but still rather complicated. So this is where all the teaching happens. And this is an elaborate superstructure whose ostensible entire aim is to ensure that this guy does his job properly. So if you look at DICE, for example, where DICE comes in is there, the National University of Education Planning and Administration. And if you look at something like NAS, which is in the NCERT, so that comes in over there. So one thing which automatically you can see is that most of the data collection efforts are essentially driven by agencies which are at the national level. And these guys collect data from different places. But if you look at the, especially the academic support and support structures which are supposed to help out the headmasters and the teachers, most of these guys don't directly talk to your national level agencies, but it's intermediated through a structure where you have block education officers, you have cluster resource centers, you have what's called a school management committee, which is made up of parents. So these are the actual people who interact with your schools and your headmasters at the grassroots. Now, if you look at the broad types of data which the election, which the education system in India collects, this is not an exhaustive categorization, but gives you some flavor of the kinds of things which you collect. There is the financial data, which is budgets, allocations, releases, expenditures. There is physical data, which is classrooms, desks, teaching material, computers. There is data which I'm broadly calling data on access to education. So this includes things like, are all children attending school? So that's enrollment numbers, how many teachers you have, how many, so essentially to ensure that every child is actually going to school and getting taught there. And finally, you have data on learning. So which is to say that once all I've finished all the other preconditions, what are children learning in school? So these are, this is the kind of rough conceptually how you can break down the different types of data which is internally generated by the public education system. So if you look at financial data, both the central government and the state governments allocate funds, and these flow through many parallel routes. Most districts are covered, but some schools are uncovered by electronic banking. So while you'll have real-time data available for fund positions for, let's say, a district education office, if you want to know how much money a school has, or more importantly, if the school headmaster wants to know how much money he has, he's rather handicapped because his bank account is unlikely to be covered by electronic banking. And even if it is, since the bank is located in a physically different location, he has no access to the very basic data, which is how much funds do I have in my school account. More significantly, because of the multiplicity of routes, let me just explain what I mean by multiplicity of routes. So going back to the structure, so you find that in the administrative structure there are essentially two parallel routes. There is the state line department route, which is the education department, the district and block education officer, and there is the SSA route. SSA is the Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan, which is a major flagship program of the government of India. So funds flow through both these routes to the schools. So if you take a particular school, he has really no idea how much money he's entitled to in a given year because the planning processes are very different for these things. And more importantly, the timing of release of funds is essentially arbitrary and unpredictable. So if you're a headmaster in a school, not only do you have no idea how much money you're supposed to get that year or for what purpose, you also don't know when this money is going to come. So, and another problem is that even if you're thinking of it from a top-down management monitoring perspective, data on the expenditure which is actually incurred by school, because record keeping in schools tends to be mainly paper-based, it's available to the center and states only after severe time lag, sometimes up to a year. And so if you're trying to find out, have I succeeded in spending all my money in school this year, you really can't find that out until the beginning of next year. So that's as far as financial data goes. Physical data, as we've all heard, the Unified Dice does a wonderful job of collecting physical data. So it collects self-reported statistics from schools and a range of infrastructure parameters, and it's widely used at both center, state, and district levels for monitoring planning purposes. Interestingly, the Dice also creates report cards for every school, which is ostensibly supposed to be published and made available to the school. But I'm not entirely sure if the report cards are actually available physically in terms of a printout or something which is made available to the school itself. This is a good example of what a well-designed data-driven feedback mechanism. Because you have the data which is being collected, and it's also made available in a reasonably timely manner to decision makers at different levels, and they actually use it in planning purposes. But this is restricted to physical data. If you look at data on access to education, the picture is much more mixed. DICE and similar systems measure some indicators, which is the number and demographics of enrolled students, number of teachers, qualifications, and so forth. But many important indicators, like the number of children who are out of school or student attendance rates. It's one thing to have all your children enrolled in schools, but informally, we all know that the reason children attend government schools, for example, is because midday meals are served over there. And anecdotally, people will tell you that, oh, people come, eat your meals, and go away. So if you want to know, are children attending school, which classes do they attend, which classes do they not attend, this kind of data is not even collected except very patchily in terms of a survey which is conducted by NGOs or perhaps by state. Similarly, teacher attendance rates is not really captured by DICE either. So these data are not available at a national level. Learning data, the picture is again quite mixed. So NAS and ASER, as you guys have heard, are surveys which give you an overall picture for policymakers on are children learning or not. Another interesting thing which most people don't think about is the comprehensive continuing education, which is in terms of the FAs and SAs, and most state boards which mandate some kind of CCE. So the students are being tested on a reasonably regular basis, but this data is not collected, it's not really used, it's not really tracked. So if you think about, is this learning data which I'm collecting, is it going to help a teacher track the performance of a particular child? Or is it going to help a parent or a district officer diagnose performance between different schools? It's not really going to do that. Even ASER and NAS are both, I think, representative at a district level, which is helpful for high-level policymakers. But if you're, let's say, a district or a block education officer and you're trying to say which schools are doing good and how do I change, these learning assessments are not really helpful because they don't capture all schools and they're only captured a sample which is representative at a higher level. These are the weaknesses broadly in the education system. The data which is collected is used mainly at the higher levels of administration and not so much at lower levels. At the ground level, there is very poor capacity to collect or use data. District surveys. We wanted a complete picture of the entire financial picture from the national level down to a school. So we used a combination of government documents, which are including budgets, SSA numbers, financial monitoring reports, which the SSA uses internally, as well as going to schools and asking them, when did you get your money? Can I look at your bank statements? What did you get your money for? What do you think the money is for? So this helped us to develop a set of things which, I'll not get into the specific recommendations, but the interesting thing is that this data is useful to talk to different levels of government. So we end up having suggestions to give to state officers as well as government of India, as well as district and block level officers as well. And we also work with school management committees, which is a bunch of parents, to tell them that this is what the school is entitled to, this is what happened last year, these are the problems which we found. So how do you think things should be moved, and how do you think things can be changed in the next year? Another interesting thing we're doing, which is probably not really quantitative data, but it's essentially time use surveys where we follow around district education officials and block education officials to find out what it is they exactly do. Because none of them are represented in this room, and in some sense all discussions involving capacities of government officials end up becoming like this, oh, I saw this animal in the zoo and nobody really knows what it looks like or what it does. So therefore, we actually end up following these officers for about a couple of weeks, just to see in a particular day what do they end up doing, how much time do they spend looking at data, how much, when you say cluster resource centers shall provide academic support, in what form does this academic support take? And then we present this data back to the CRCCs themselves, who often are rather astonished to find that even though their job is to actually provide academic support to schools, they only spend like on average an hour and a half in schools in a month, which they should know at some point since they're doing it, but bringing it to their conscious attention, as well as the conscious attention of their higher-ups and to policymakers higher in the government, is, we think, an example of data which is being collected and also given to people who can actually take immediate actions upon it. In the field of health, another thing we've been doing, which is also applicable in education, is that we're working with district project managers in the health mission to create a dashboard of key indicators which is useful for planning and implementation at a monthly or weekly level. So basically, you know that you're collecting all this data, which ends up getting aggregated only yearly in Delhi or in your state capital. But the problem is that the person who's actually collecting this data has never really bothered to look at it or understand it. So we try to work with them and try to figure out what are the things which they would like to know to fix problems which they perceive. And we use that to develop a dashboard which they can just look at and quickly glean key indicators so that we can help them plan and implement programs in their district. So just our thoughts on overall how data can help catalyze reform. So these are the four things which we think are the major things to be done. First, you need to identify at every level what information is needed and how this information needs to be presented. Next, you need to develop a mechanism for regular data collections at government and external partner levels. It's not enough to just say once in a year that I need to collect dice, therefore now I will spend a week ordering all teachers to survey and fill in forms. What you need to do is incentivize people to measure and look at data on a regular basis and use it to change things. One thing which DICE has been really helpful and NAS as well, but which probably needs to be extended to more types of data, is to create an integrated and reliable data which is updated in a reasonably timely manner and make it accessible to the public. And by public, I don't just mean people who are capable of using Excel or Google OpenRefine to clean up this data. But by public, I also mean teachers, parents, panchayat officials, people who are in a position to demand accountability through teachers and when they're presented with data they can use. And lastly, but something which we think gets talked about very little, you need to empower government officials at very different levels to be able to actually use this data to change decisions and change plans. If all is going to happen is that the data is made available at high levels and that people who actually collect this data have no power to actually change things, then the problems of poor quality, poor incentivization will remain, because I know that whatever data I'm collecting, I'm not going to use it, and it's not going to make any difference to me until it comes back down as a diktat from the center next year. So therefore, that's a very powerful incentive to collect poor quality data. So a more decentralized administrative process in which government officials at different levels are empowered to change things based on the data they are actually collecting, we think is a very crucial part of the system which has been neglected. So far.